seat. The back seat has some missing parts, so we're trying to update that. So what we're eventually going to do, I'm going to put that on the TV, I'll put that a little bit. If you're sitting in the back, move up front, don't sit in the back of the chair. And we're going to go through the internal cockpit. And it's more of a discussion, not a lecture, but if you have a question, some of you, how many people have some aero experience? Okay, I may say some technical terms that you may not understand. That's the way it is. If I say HSI for horizontal situation indicator, you may not know what that means. But if you have a map, if you're looking down on a map, I-5 north or 210, you're looking at what? You're looking at a horizontal situation. It's just a method of knowing where you are and where you're going. So I may say a couple of technical things, and if you get confused, say, hey, Bozo, explain it in simple terms. Sometimes we get a little too technical. And if you have a question, just yell it out. There's noise here. We want to make it interactive. We're going to limit it to 1 hour. Why? Half an hour later, we're going to do a presentation. Okay, so let's not do that. Okay, so here we go. Whoops. Okay. An engineering marvel. What year is it? 59. Designed in 1959, the A-12 flies in 62, the SR flies in 64. We can't build a car in 7 years. This thing was built in 28 months. And it still remains the world's fastest airplane. It is the world's fastest airplane. It has never been duplicated. We'll show you why. Okay. We're going to look at environmental, cooling, flight dynamics. And I'll be as general as I can. We're going to go through the entire cockpit from left to right. And you're going to be surprised. If you don't have a handout, I got some handouts for you. You're going to be surprised how archaic the cockpit is. It's analog. What does analog mean? Analog versus digital. Digital are counters. Analog are dials. Okay? And we want to be analog. What kills a computer faster than anything? Heat. And this thing. Surface temperature is up at 500 to 600 degrees. The back end is at 3400. So analog works. Digital at that time probably would not have worked. It would not have worked. Okay, there's the new glass cockpit. It's a joke. It's a joke. Anybody know what that is? Ah, not you. Anybody know what that is? No? No? Ready? Ready? Look at the size of that guy. Has anybody been up to the Evergreen Air Museum? Has that been up there? You sit in that thing, you sit behind, it's got a 300-gallon oil tank sitting behind the cockpit. This tank, you think it's a fuel tank, it's an oil tank for the engines. And I never knew how it even got off the ground, but if you go up to Evergreen, you can actually sit there and put on a Howard Hughes hat and be really cool, but it's really an interesting machine. Okay, we're a little bit more constrained. This is the B model, that's my little position back there as an instructor, but it's kind of tight with the spacesuit. It's not overwhelmingly uncontrolled, but it's a tight fit. And I've been in the suit for 9 hours, Cherry's been in the suit for 12 hours. So by the time you eat breakfast, till the time you eat supper, we're in the airplane in a suit. And that's the way it has to be. You can't be claustrophobic. That's one of the key issues. Okay, so there's the A model, and we're going to be talking about the front seat. That's what it looks like, sitting there. And we've had missions 13 hours, sitting in the airplane for 13 hours, going through 5 KC-135 tankers that we love. Is the airplane usable without tankers? Flying around a flagpole. Without a KC-135, we're useless, absolutely useless. Every time we roll up to them, we give them the wave or a boom, and we say, we love you. Give us the gas, we love you. Hey, we're just the renters, the maintenance guys own the airplane. We rent the airplane, maintenance owns the airplane. We love it. No complaints about the food, and don't poop. Don't poop. We can pass urine, but you have to manage your diet in terms of the solid waste. We've had accidents, but you know what happens? Even though we have a bladder that separates the head from the rest of the torso, those molecules find a way up, don't they? They just find, you know, they just find a way to get where they don't want to go. You know, and after about a half an hour, you go, I got to smell this for the next 8 hours, you know. So we try not to poop in this suit. That's what we try not to do. Okay. That's our simulator. And you get about 300 hours in that simulator before you even fly the airplane. And if you don't pass the simulator check, you don't fly the airplane. You only get 5 rides before we check out. 4 rides, what's a check ride? And if you don't pass the simulator check before you even jump in the airplane, you're gone. And some people are gone because they cannot, oh, I don't need to fly the simulator, I'll just fly the airplane. That's not the way it works. You must pass the simulator check. That's the back seat. We don't have a good visual in the back seat. We're trying to do this, but this is where the goodies are. We're just the guys that get the airplane from point A to point B at home safely. This guy has got all the sensors, all the nav, all the defensive systems. When things happen, he's the guy that presses the buttons. And when we go home, the maintenance people want to talk to me. Who do the intelligence people want to talk to? They want to talk to this guy. Because if we don't get the take, the whole mission has been useless. Each mission is about $1 million. It was about $1 million. So you have different systems here, but you have over here, you've got defensive systems. He has optical systems. We have astro trackers, and we track by stars. You all have phones, right? You all have GPS phones. I got my GPS phone. I'm within 50 feet. What do you need for your GPS phone? You need satellites. You've got 24 of them sitting there. This airplane needed nothing except the stars. The stars weren't going away. If we taxied out in Mars field right now on a clear day, you can't see the stars, but the astro tracker, and if you go right up the door, you'll see up the stairs, you'll see the little R2-D2 window behind the rear seat. That's an astro tracker. The astro tracker, with an atomic clock, we're searching for stars. As we taxi down the taxiway, it's locking on to 3 to 4 stars. The stars are there. We had a star catalog. And guess what? It's plus, what year is it? About 1962. We're plus or minus 300 feet. But you say, oh, 300 feet. Do we need any satellites? We need stars. If it's cloudy, we have to get up above the clouds. But plus or minus 300 feet, and the cameras know exactly where they're looking, plus or minus 300 feet, 45 miles either side of the airplane. So we can sit there and look 45 miles into a country with a resolution of 18 inches from 83,000 feet. You have your license plate? Hold up your license plate. We can read that license plate from 83,000 feet with optical cameras. What year is it? It's about 1964. That's how good the optics were. It was amazing. So if you get up there, look right behind the RSO seat, and you'll see a little dome. And that's our R2-D2 astro tracker lens that goes right through the top of the airplane. Okay, so what we're gonna do, oh, this is the B model. If you wanna find something that's really, really crowded, this guy, see, I'm losing my laser. The guy in the back, who's the instructor, is sitting right there. It is really, really a crowded machine. We only fly that airplane about 3 to 4 hours at one time. It just gets too taxing. But that's our trainer. And the trainer knows when to screw up. It's a great trainer. It knows when to burp and when to unstart. And we demonstrate all that stuff. And the trainer, it's a one-of-a-kind airplane, and it's one of the best trainers around because it just has this sense of knowing when to screw up. Students. So what I'm going to do, give me just a second, I'm going to boot this up, and what you're going to see a complete picture of the front seat, and I'm going to zoom in and zoom out, and I'm going to go around the cockpit and show you how it looks. If you have a question, what do you do? I got a question. That's it. So give me a second. Hopefully this will boot up. We have a hotspot here, which should work. Let me see. And I think you'll see the archaicness. There we go. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to sit here, and what I can do, this is the front seat. Oh, those are not lights. That's what? That's just sealant. Somebody yesterday said, oh, those lights really look cool. No, those are not lights. That's just sealant. You wouldn't want to get into a commercial airplane with that, but this airplane had both windscreens removed. And if I touch that windscreen at speed, that's 2.5 inches thick, and it's 620 degrees. I can put my hand out, not for long, and I touch the windscreen. About 20 seconds later, my glove gets hot. That, if we're doing Mach 3.2, that windscreen is 620 degrees, and it's 2.5 inches thick. Okay, so what we're gonna do, it's not glass, it's a quartz. It's a coarse lead mixture, because why? It's now embedded in titanium, right? So that has to expand at the same rate as the titanium. Remember, the airplane's going from minus 60 degrees to plus 700, back down to minus 60, back up to 700, and everything has to do it at the right time. Is that gonna make sense? Including the engine. Including the engine. Okay, what year is it? You're right. It's about 1962 when the engine was completed, when we found all the pieces and parts to make the engine run. Still state of the art. The engine has not been duplicated. We haven't built a Mach 3 engine better than this engine. This engine is 50 years old. It is still state of the art. The inlet, ram, turbo bypass for this airplane is still state of the art. Okay, so what we can do is we can zoom in, and I can zoom out, and I can kind of go like this. I don't want to get you upset. I think I'll do it as slow as possible. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna start with my left hand right here, and we're gonna go around the cockpit. There's the canopy rail on the left side, and I'll zoom in, and you'll see it's really archaic. When I first jumped in the airplane, I went, my goodness, look at all these old instruments. And the guy said, it's really an old airplane. It's a pretty old airplane. So let's kind of zoom in, and if you look back here, these are circuit breakers. There's about 20 rows of circuit breakers back here. You have to know about where 5 or 6 are, but you can't get to them. So we have a circuit breaker puller up here, and we go back 3, down 2. So you have to know where about 8 or 9 of the key circuit breakers are, and you feel, count circuit breakers, and you have a circuit breaker puller, and you can pull them and reset them. But we cannot see them, we have to feel them. Okay, if we zoom in, there's all our lights, exterior and interior lights. We have 3 oxygen systems, 2 with here, 1 here. So we have 3 oxygen systems in the airplane, 2 for operation, 1 for emergency. This is a ultra-high frequency radio in the front seat. So me in the front, I have an ultra-high frequency and a VHF, which the normal airliners use. The back seat has another set of radios, has an electronic ranging, and also has a high frequency system, which is worldwide. If anybody went to the dinner last night, we went through the ejection sequence for the last airplane that flew, that they bailed out, and he's on the HF, having all the codes, what the failures are. So we have total communication, plus electronic communication with the tankers. We do not talk to the tankers. I've been 7 hours in the air, haven't talked to anybody. 4 tanker refuelings, worst weather in the world, you come down and the tanker rolls out 3 miles ahead of you every single time. Every single time. A KC-135 rolls ahead of you and you said nothing to them. It's all electronic ranging. You hook up, you wave to the boomer, we get under the airplane and we say, we love you. Give me another 80,000 pounds of gas, we love you. That's what we do. Okay, so this is radios. These are the lights. Okay, now I'm gonna come up here slightly. There's the canopy rail. That's a night light. These switches here seem innocuous, but they're really not. I'll zoom in here. And we can do maintenance on the engine. This is one of the few airplanes in the world where I can actually vary the fuel flow of the engine and vary the EGT. So we can do minor maintenance at speed to tune the engines to maximum efficiency if we have to do that. Normally it's automatic, but we can do it, and we have done it. These two switches seem very innocuous, but it really is how good you fly the airplane. The inlets, and if you look at the inlet, you'll see some, they look like shutters on the inlet. You'll see the forward shutters and the aft shutters. The forward shutters are called forward doors. and we manage this turbo bypass engine by managing the air through the system. These doors, these aft doors, we control manually, and hopefully when we're at speed, we keep those forward doors closed. Because when they open, that subsonic air flowing into a supersonic windstream, and it provides a lot of drag. Drag on this airplane at supersonic speeds is mainly from the inlets. And we can manage that and change that with this system. Okay, here are the throttles, and I'll back up just a little bit. There are the throttles, there are two throttles. We have a friction lock. Normally when we set the throttles, we can lock them. We can tighten the throttles down. These are counters. When we light the afterburner, we have 16 afterburner lights, and we count them here. We're coming over here, there's the, I'll zoom out just a second. There's the windscreen, and we're coming in to what I would say is the environmental area. Let's go right here, okay? Yep. Here's our, we have a map projector. We can have it automatic or manually. We'll show you the map projector, and it'll take the Mach and run the map projector at the speed of the airplane. Or we can do it manually. The key for the airplane, you never lose where you are. Front seat, back seat. You never know not where you're going and not where you've been and where you are precisely. Because in a book, it says when you're going 36 miles a minute, if you don't know where you are, you're 36 miles further away from where you don't know where you are. So the key here, situational awareness from both seats, you know exactly where you are every single second, and you're thinking 400 miles ahead of the airplane. If I have a problem right here, I'm not landing here. I'm landing 300 miles downstream. So you're thinking 400 miles ahead of the airplane. Every single minute, you're projecting 400 miles. What's happening? What's happening? Okay, so, you'll see it on the stick. Got it? Okay. This is our temperature control, we have manifold controls, we have ram dump, we can actually dump the pressure in the cockpit. We have our suit heat, we have face heat, we have electric wires. If you look at the helmet, you may not see them. There are electric wires running through the glass helmet. We never want to ever fog up. We can heat it if we even fog up. So it's called face heat. Okay? We have our temperature controls, we have our bay controls, and this is really important. That says 160 degrees. We try to keep the bay temperatures, and if you look at this airplane, it looks like a tube, isn't it true? And there's this nice chime that comes over. Everything in the airplane is forward of the chime. This chime and the chime on the other side has everything. Cameras, sensors, locks, all the navigation equipment, all the radio equipment. There's nothing behind this system. And we try to keep this part of the airplane below 140 degrees. If it gets up to 160, 170, things start to happen. What's the surface temperature of the airplane? It's 550. Take your turkey, crank it up another 150 degrees in your oven. That's what the surface temperature is. We have two great air conditioning systems. We take 1300 degree air and we cool it to minus 40 degrees. And we're blowing 100 cubic feet per minute through the entire bay section at minus 40 degrees, and it keeps the front of the airplane at about 140. It's so good, if my RSO says, hey, I'm a little hot back here, I can blow snow in the back seat at Mach 3.2. And the front canopy is 620 degrees, and I'm blowing little crystals of ice water snow in the back seat. Oh, it's okay, heat it up a little bit. That's how good this system is. Okay, so there's our bay temps. I can switch this for the left bay or the right bay. There's our indicator. Our refrigeration packs, there are two right behind the RSO's pack. We have our gear system. We want three lights on or three lights off. Does that make sense to you? We always want three lights on or three. We don't want one light or two lights on. That's kind of a bummer. Okay, we have our gear handle. A couple of other switches for anti-skid. If it's wet, we can, it's just like your car. You have, how many people have any skid in their car? Everybody's got any skid in their car. How many people have cycled it and tried it? Tried it, yeah. Same here. This is an important one. We fly at 26,000 feet cabin pressure. How do we survive? We're flying almost at the top of Mount Everest. How do we survive? We're flying at 26,000 feet cabin pressure. What's that over there? That's a pressure suit. So basically, from the time we close our helmet, we're breathing 100% oxygen. And if we're flying for 13 hours, we're breathing 100% oxygen. It gets a little unnerving with your eyes and your nostrils, it dries you out. But if we depressurize, and we've had depressurizations, the suit will keep you at 35,000 feet. And if you're breathing 100% oxygen at 35,000 feet, it's like you're at 12,000. You'll make it, you'll be able to come down. You're not gonna be comfortable, you're gonna be rigid in the suit. You may not be able to get the most of the flight controls, but you can control the airplane and get down. So, but we're flying at 26,000. Okay, liquid oxygen, we have three systems. So that what I consider is the environmental system. And in 900 hours and many, many minute missions, I've had two refrigeration failures, only two. That's how good this system. I've had two generator failures. How many people had a battery failure in their car? How many people have more than one battery failure? There you go. You've had more battery failures than I've had generator failures in a Mach 3.2 airplane. That's how good this guy is. Okay, we're gonna come over here, and I'll zoom out a bit. Is this making sense? Is this okay? Okay, I need your feedback. Whoops. Nothing here. Okay. There's the drag chute. Pops out. This is a very important gauge. This is the compressor inlet. Oops, let me get over here. So this right here is a compressor inlet temperature gauge. You see it says 450? Everybody see that? That's not 450 Fahrenheit. That's 450 centigrade. That's 800 degrees Fahrenheit. This is what this inlet senses at Mach 3.2. The inlet temperature for this inlet is 800 degrees centigrade. The back end of the airplane is 3,400 degrees. The exit temperature for the engine is 3,200 to 3,400 degrees, and it works perfectly. In 900 hours, I've lost only three engines. That's how good they're designed. Okay, that's an airspeed indicator. Let me just back out here a little bit. We really don't use this very much. I'll show you why. This is called a triple display indicator. We think it's digital, but it's not a digital gauge. It's just a set of what? It's just a set of rotary counters. It's basically analog. It's just a rotary counter. Up here, our angle of attack indicator, which is absolutely critical. This is our air refueling switches. We have some warning lights. And the plane is flying at 6 degrees angle of attack. If you see pictures of the tanker is going as fast as it can, like this, and we're sitting behind the airplane at 6.5 degrees angle of attack. At speed, the plane is flying at 6 degrees angle of attack. It's just riding a shockwave. And the efficiency is absolutely amazing. Okay, let's back out. Coming down here to the inlet systems. Okay, that's one light I don't want to see. What does it say? It says RSO ejected. I'd rather not see that. I'd rather not. We have a warning system. I can give him an alert. And the last plane that we had the accident in Philippines in 89, both guys jumped out, both guys made it. That kind of closed the program. We have our inlet system, and this is very interesting. Oh, this is our TDI. This is what we fly with. It's keys. We'll tell you so much about that. Altitude and Mach. So we're really not using the airspeed indicator. We're using the subsonic, but supersonic, this is our key. You want to level off at 73,000 feet at 410 keys. We want to be doing Mach 3. And the inlet temperature is about 650. If we go faster, temperature is nonlinear, and at Mach 3.25, the inlet temperature for that is 800 degrees. And what does the engine say? Give me more. That's what it says, give me more. Okay, we have inlets. They like to be automatic, but we can control them. These are the forward doors. And the forward doors, you can see it. You can see the little louvers, the front louvers. And I can control the forward doors with what? Remember those two little innocuous switches? Yeah, I can manually control the forward doors with the aft doors. You're paid to manage the inlets. The engine at speed only provides about 20% of the thrust. The engine is just a pump to keep the hydraulics going, the electrics going. The inlet provides about 55 to 60%. And if you go to the back of this airplane, you'll see a set of louvers, free-floating louvers. If you look at supersonic flight, you wanna get your hose to squirt further, what do? You open the nozzle and you put your finger on it, isn't that true? You close the nozzle, true? And it squirts further. The reverse is true for supersonic flight. Because water is not compressible. If I want the hose to squirt further in supersonic flight, I have to open the louvers. So what happens in the back? They're free floating. We don't control them. As the plane goes faster, the louvers are closed now. I'll do this way. The louvers open and open and open and open. The outside pressure is less, the inside pressure is greater, and the louvers open and open. Now, if you open that for a hose, would the water squirt further or not as far? Not as far. In supersonic flight, the gas goes faster. Those louvers provide almost 20% of the thrust at speed because they almost double their area. And in supersonic flight, we can multiply the velocity by 1.5 times, and it's coming out like a rocket. What's the temperature back there? 3,400 degrees, coming out the back end of this airplane. What year is it? It's about 1962, and it works. Okay, so here we go. We have a G-meter. It's a very low-G airplane. Why would it be a low-G airplane? Look at it. It's got 82,000 pounds of gas in it sometimes. And we never, the most G's we pull is when we're in the traffic pattern, about 2 G's. You don't want to get above 2.5 G's. It's an incredibly low G airplane. It wants to go fast and straight and never come back to the same place twice. One pass and we're gone. Quick question.
Where do you keep that 82,000 pounds of fuel in this airplane?
If you look at this, that looks like a soda can, right? And then we have the chime from the Yariso station back to the tail are 5 tanks. The inboard wing inside of the inlet has another set of tanks. So we keep it from the inlet in and on a cylinder straight through the airplane itself. The airplane's a flying gas tank. It weighs 60 and it carries about 82,000 pounds of gas. Just a flying gas tank. Okay, we have inlet controls. Let me go back here, zoom out. Yeah, we have a couple of inlet systems. We have our trim switches. And here's our stick who asked the question about the interphone. Okay, here, right here for me, let me show you. Right there, it says IMPH, so I can talk. Once we get in the cockpit, we never see each other. There's no cameras, and you're trained so well, you know exactly what the other person's thinking. And we talk, after you train, you don't talk a lot either. You go 600-700 miles, and you don't talk. Everybody knows exactly what they're doing. Okay. This is the trim, right? The trim is right here. Oh, no, yeah. That's also a mic, but we normally use the stick mic. Coming down, let's go up here. A standby attitude indicator. For our attitude, we have a main attitude indicator, and these bars become very important in supersonic flight. One is a track bar, which tells us our course, and if we're plus or minus, if we get 100 feet off, that bar moves. We got 100 feet off, that bar moves. We know exactly where we are. If you make a 1 degree pitch change at 3.2, it's 2,500 feet per minute. So we're flying in tenths of degrees. We're managing the pitch in tenths of degrees. We want to have the airplane as stable as possible. And this helps us a lot. Coming down, remember what I said about a horizontal situation indicator? That's our map horizontal situation indicator, and that tells us where we're going and if we're on track. That's a compass rose. Coming down, that's our map projector. And remember, we have a little gauge over here that tells us we can make it Mach 3 or Mach 3.2. And the map is a running paper map, which tells us exactly where the next turn point is. So we both know exactly where we are. Exactly where we are. Okay, coming down. Okay, between the seat, there's the ejection seat, and there's the canopy jettison handle right there. Okay, this is the ejection seat, right over here. Okay, the surface limiter, as we take off and get the gear up, that's a manual limiter which manually limits our rudder travel. We don't want to overstress the airplane with rudder travel, so we limit the rudders when we get above 400 G's. We have 48 annunciator lights, and you have to know where they are. 48 annunciator panel lights. We have an alternate gear release. We have our, when we went to DAPIX, a digital system, on the left side of the airplane in one of the bays, there are three computers, and each computer can be reset with these three switches. The computers are now running the inlets, and the computers can run the inlets a little better than we could. They're a little more susceptible to, we were more susceptible to unstarts. The computers probably reduced the unstarts by about 50%, but didn't eliminate them. But these are the computer reset buttons. Alternate, if I want to drop the gear manually, we lose pressure. It's a big handle. You pull it out, hold it, and the gear drops manually. We mechanically unlock the gear, and it just free falls down. Yeah, I'm going to back out and come back in. So here we are. Here we are. So there's the front seat, and we've covered from here to here, over to the inlet system, flight control, where we have the flight systems, the stick, all the caution and warning lights, and then we're going to go back through here. Whoops, I screw that up sometimes. Let's go here. And tough to see. There's our master caution light. We don't want to see that. That's a big red light, and it flashes. Master caution means you have something that's serious. A caution light, we may have a warning light that tells us something. And sometimes we just disregard it. You have to know which systems you can manage and which systems you may not want to even touch right now. We all have a clock, a couple of lights, altitude, vertical velocity. These two gauges we don't even use supersonic. What do we use? Remember that one? We use the triple display indicator because these guys are the airspeed, altitude, and vertical velocity are susceptible to compressibility. And there's gross errors, really gross errors. This is calibrated and it's with a different computer. And we use this exclusively for supersonic flight. We fly keys. This may read 410 at 75,000, and this may read 520. Which one is right? It's the 410. So it's the errors that we want to avoid. So we really don't use the airspeed indicator, the altimeter, or the vertical velocity when we're flying supersonic. Okay, coming down, all our nav, we can fly an Astro Tracker, INS, TACAN, all these navigation systems are on the airplane. Now, as I said, what does R2-D2 do? Does it require satellites? Does it require satellites? No. It requires what? Stars. Can if you walk outside right now, you probably can't see a single star. We have a star catalog. We load R2-D2 right behind the RSO. R2-D2, we almost want to paint them with a little blue stripe. A crane comes out with R2-D2. Loads R2-D2 in the airplane with the mission. There's a clock, there's an atomic clock accurate to probably 1/10,000th of a second. And the map system knows exactly where the stars should be. So it goes through a tracking system, and it's looking for that area for the star. It senses that star, and it looks for another star in a narrow area. When we lock on to three stars, what do we get? We update. You ask some of my students here, Mac, we're taxiing down the taxiway, right?
Maybe.
And the tracker will update. The tracker, I'll say, here comes the update. We haven't even taken off yet. We're going down the taxiway, and it's so accurate that the tracker will update, and all these gauges, all these instruments right here will move. It tells you exactly where you are, plus or minus what? 300 feet. And it updates. Here comes the update. I can watch. Here comes the update. Bing! Boink! And the ANS updates the INS, and the tracker moves over and tells you exactly where you are. That's how good it is.
How many stars do you track?
We can track 7 or 8 stars at one time, but we need 3. Which airplane has that system in it right now as a backup? What costs $2 billion a system? The B-2? The Stealth Bomber? The Astro Tracker, updated from this airplane, is the backup system for the B-2 Bomber. Okay, so here we go, we're coming down. No, visibility. It knows the stars are there. It's a thermal system, okay? Your eyes are not focused on that frequency. But it knows exactly where the stars are. The stars are there. You just can't see them with your optics. With them, it can see them. Okay, we go to engine instruments, RPM gauges, EGT gauges, and this looks like a digital gauge. It's just a set of what? Just a set of counters. It's just a set of roller counters. We're coming down to exhaust. I'll back up for a second here. There we are. There you go. We went down to navigation. Here's all our engine instruments. We have two RPM gauges. We have two EGT gauges. They're covered right now. They are covered for night. That's our fire lights. We really don't want those to come on. We really don't want a fire light to come on. Here's our nozzles, and this is the back of the airplane. And the engine is a constant speed engine. That's when we're doing Mach 3.2. If I take the throttle, if you take the throttle off the gas of the car, it slows down. If you pull this throttle back from afterburner to idle, the engine RPM doesn't change virtually at all. It changes by about 200 RPM. It's just a pump. Remember, it's only providing about less than 20% of the total thrust. We just want it to be a pump to run the hydraulics, the electrics, and to keep the air flowing through the inlet. About 40% of the air is completely bypassed. It never goes through the engine. It goes around the engine, and we put it out the back, relight it, and blow it out the back end at what temperature? 3,200 to 3,400 degrees. It's the greatest engine ever designed. Has it been duplicated? No, it hasn't. It hasn't been duplicated. Okay. Fuel flow is pretty interesting, and we're just about on time here. Sorry about that. Get over here. And this will impress you. And I know Gil's in the audience, so I'm going to do it in gallons, Gil. Oh, you see this? You see this here? See this alternate release handle? Gil had an engine failure at Okinawa, and then was the engine with the hydraulic pressure for the alternate release handle. And Frankie in the back says, oh, alternate release handle full? And what happened? The wire broke. True? The wire broke. Junk happens. Okay, let me go back here, and I'm gonna zoom in here. Okay, these are our fuel flow gauges. That's hydraulic. We have two subsystems, two main systems from each engine. We have oil pressure for each engine, and we have fuel flow. We start the engines and taxi to the end of the runway. We just use 5,000 pounds of gas, 2.5 tons, just to get to the end of the runway. 2 plus minutes later, we're at 25,000 feet. We've used another 5,000 pounds of gas. We've used 5 tons of gas from the time we start the engines until the time we level off and go to a tanker. As we climb up from the end of the runway at 400 keys, the engines are burning 72,000 pounds per hour per engine. We're burning 145,000 pounds. Okay, let's convert that to gallons, divided by about 7. What do you think? It's let's see, divide 14 by 7, we're burning 20,000 gallons per hour. 20,000 gallons per hour. We only want to do that for a few minutes. At speed, the engines are burning only 19,000 pounds per hour. Or about what? Divide that by 6, about 3,000 gallons. That's how good this system is. And we're doing Mach 3.2. 36 miles a minute, and we're looking at the fuel flow going, you gotta be kidding me, you gotta be joking. Good question, because we want to be on time for the next question.
Can you give me the average fuel on average speed when you cruise, when you're going somewhere?
The average, okay, we fly at 3 basic systems. If we want to do high bank turns and we're narrow, it's 2.8. If we're flying at 3.0, it's about 1,750 knots.
We fly
in continuous afterburner.
Is that right?
Continuous afterburner. We fly in afterburner for an hour and 10 minutes. The engine says, give me more, give me more. Okay, we're coming down, so that's the fuel flow. Let's go back up here quickly. I'm gonna back out. Okay, here's our fuel. I'll back out just a second here. We're on the right canopy. We're on the right canopy. This is my right hand here. We're on the right canopy. We're going to go back in. There's our fuel flow gauge. What does it say? 80,000 pounds. Remember, when you do it in pounds, it's density compensated for. The colder it is, you get more fuel. I was refueling over northern Alaska coming back in the winter, and I got 83,000 pounds of gas on the airplane because the tanker was sitting upstairs, and it was minus 60 outside. The fuel was just cold, so we're passing 80, got 81, and we pressured off, got it, we got 80, almost 83,000 pounds of gas. It was really, really, really cold. So gallons are not compensated pounds, it's density compensated for. Okay, we have our locks, we pressurize the system with liquid nitrogen so things don't blow up. As we lose fuel, we pump liquid nitrogen into the fuel system tanks. Why? Liquid nitrogen, it turns into gaseous nitrogen. 71% of the atmosphere is what? 79% of the atmosphere is what? It's the best fire retardant in the world. It's inert. So we pump the airplane with an inert gas for safety reasons. What year is it? It's still 1964. Can you imagine the engineers who built this thing? I mean, it's just amazing. Okay, coming down, here's our fuel tanks. Let's go here. We got fuel tanks. We have our fuel shut off. We can transfer fuel. Remember, the Concorde flies by transferring fuel. We can transfer fuel between tanks to keep the center of gravity within limits. I can transfer aft, I can transfer forward. So we're managing fuel from different parts of the airplane to keep our center of gravity at an optimum level. Okay, coming down, there's our transfer, our electrical switches. We have multiple generators. We have two huge 40 kVA generators on the airplane. How many generators have I lost? You lost more batteries than I lost generators. These generators are on the engine at 550 degrees sometimes, and the generators just keep going. In 900 hours, I've only lost two generators. That's how good the system is. Okay, what's interesting, I made a mistake in my second B model ride. There are the generator switches. Do you see something unusual there? You see something unusual there? On is down. Up is emergency. My second flight, they said generator's on, and what did I do? I turned into emergency. Got to shut down, restart up. And it happens. You have to keep training and training and training. The goal is to have two people in the airplane not make the same mistake at the same time. I've made mistakes in the front seat. My back seat is with Jerry. What's going on up there? It's not a you stupid guy. Or I'll say, hey, Ron, what's going on back there? You're always married. You're always communicating. What's the goal? Get the tank, get the airplane. You're always integrated and communicating. That's the only thing. Okay, we have all our electrics over here. Here's our fuel selector panel. I can select our fuel tanks. Okay, coming down. We have our autopilot, and it's kind of a rudimentary autopilot. It's automatic and track, but we don't have an automatic pitch. We have to fly the pitch. Remember, we're flying in tenths of degrees, very, very minor pitch changes. And when you're going through a take area, you want the airplane to be as stable as possible. Nobody's talks, everybody is just focused on making. If the airplane starts wobbling at 3.2, the optics start to take a hit, the radar takes a hit. You want it really, really, really stable. So this is our basic autopilot, and I'll resume in here. And it says, autopilot. We have three computers, so we have three sensors for the computers. There's the pitch wheel, there's the roll wheel. We can turn things on and turn things off. But when we're flying, we're not handling the stick. One hand's on the throttle, and one hand is on the pitch wheel, and we're managing the system on the autopilot. That's what we want. Can the bird be hand flown at 3.2? It's a beautiful airplane to fly through. Beautiful, you can hand fly. Beautiful. Okay, zoom off here. Okay, coming back. Here's our navigation, we have back end, we have all our intercom, I can switch microphones. We have the nav system, we have our intercom system, a few inlet systems, we have an ILS system. So we have ILS, an instrument landing system, we can do astro tracking, we have four different radios, the RSO can range on the tanker. So we have multiple communication systems to get where we need to go and to keep people informed. And basically, during an ops mission, we're not talking to Terry's been through five refuelings. Have they talked to the tanker once? Nope. Hook up. Hi, Boomer. How about 60,000? He loved you. Punch off. Next tanker. Ranging. No vision. No verbal communication. Every single time for an ops mission, where are they? The worst weather, the middle of the night, the darkest Pacific hole, they roll out. We love the KC-135. They roll out 3 miles ahead of you, and the boom is down, and you look up and you get another 80,000 pounds of gas. That's how good the entire system works. 15,000 miles, the tankers are set. They know when to be there. They're there every single time. Some of them will ask me, what if they're not? What's my question? The answer, they're there every single time. That's the key. And that's what happens. It's a different ballgame. It's a different ballgame. Okay, so then we're back here, and what do we have at the end? What do we have here? Circuit breakers. We can't see those either sometimes, so we have to what? We use our little circuit breaker puller. We go, okay, we're doing the heat circuit breaker. Let's see, down four, back two. Let's reset it and see what happens. And that's what we do. So let's go back. There's the injection seat. Oh, let me go back here. And zoom out briefly. Do that. And I can touch with my left hand or right hand, but my left hand, I can touch this windscreen. The windscreen is about right there. What's the temperature? 600 plus degrees. And remember, the airplane, the thermal stresses on this airplane are truly amazing. How many people have been to Phoenix? Landing in Phoenix in the summer. It's 140 on the tarmac. And your 777 or your 737 Southwest is sitting on a tarmac at 140 degrees. You get on in your shorts. And people bitch about the peanuts, right? A half an hour later, where is it? It's at 41,000 feet. What's the temperature? It's minus 50. This airplane, you're sitting in a 72-degree pressurized soda can. You're complaining about the peanuts. 6 inches from your face is death. It's death. It goes up to minus 40, comes back down to 140, and it does it 6 or 7 times a day. The thermal stresses on those systems are enormous, and they work perfectly almost every single time. Now take a look at this guy built in 1961. We've been to minus 60. We go up to 600, down to minus 60, up to 600, down again, maybe 5 times. And we come home and say, yeah, you know, we had a broken EGT gauge, we popped the oil circuit breaker, a little bit of flux in the nozzle. Are you kidding me? This just went through 6 thermal shocks and we broke 2 minor things in the air. That's how well this is. Hey, Gil, how many ANS trackers have you lost? How many? Zero. That's how good the ANS tracker is. I have never lost an ANS tracker. We've had a couple. Okay, I've lost more generators than I've lost an ANS tracker. I've lost more engines than I've lost an ANS tracker. So the question is, when you look at it, it looks archaic, but for 25 years, 35 years, it's worked almost every single time. We've got a few minutes for questions, if you'll ask anything. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead, and you have to talk this way. That's the point. You know what? You have a good point. What's the problem right now? Oh, what the military has now. Okay? What's the problem? I'm pointing to it. It's propulsion. It's propulsion. Why? Okay, has anybody here been in the Concorde? I've been in the Concorde, okay? When you put your face against the window, it's not cold. If you put your face against the window for 737, it gets kind of cool, right? It's cold, because it's minus 50. It's not minus 50 on the surface of the airplane. The Concorde surface temperature is 220 degrees. Boil a pot of water on your stove. That's the surface temperature for the French, British Concorde. Why? Rub your hands together. What is it? Okay, now we're going from Mach 2 to Mach 3.2, what's the surface temperature of this guy? We've gone from 220 to 550. We've doubled the temperature, we've doubled the frictional temperatures, the thermal stresses for 1 Mach. Let's go to Mach 4. What do you think? It may be up at 9, the surface temperature is 900 degrees. There's only one way to cool the, there's only one way to cool the system. What is it? What do you need? I told you what we need. What do we need? We need cold fuel. That is the only practical way to cool the system. Why? About a millimeter above the surface here. Are you all surprised? All these bolts are sticking out. It's not sleek, it's not polished. About a millimeter above the surface, it's called the Lambert flow. Don't get too technical. The temperature is 710. The surface temperature is about 550, but just above the surface, it gets to 710 degrees. You can't radiate the heat outwards. Why? You can't go from cold to hot. It only goes from hot to cold. So surrounding this airplane is this 700 degree thermal plume, whereas that's the only way we can get the heat, thermal energy out of the airplane. We've got to put it in the fuel, and where do we put the fuel? We blow it out the back end. The inlet fuel gets to 320 degrees before it even gets to the engine. Now the question I have for you, we now have a new airline, something, got it, okay? What could be the fuels? Think of something really, really, really cold that rockets have. Come on, guys. Liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen. That may be the only way to power a Mach 4 or a Mach 5 airplane, because we cannot cool the airplane thermally. So you say, ladies and gentlemen, don't worry. As soon as we get the liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen loaded on our airliner, the fire trucks go away, you can load the airplane. Would you feel good about that? I don't know. But that may be the only way. So it's the thermal issue. We can build a machine, but we're having trouble propelling it efficiently and keeping you alive. The thermal stresses are absolutely enormous. When we get down to about 10,000 pounds of fuel here, we know the airplane's getting hot because the system can't keep us, the seat starts to heat up a little bit because the fuel is really, really, really hot. So it's going to be tough right now. It's really difficult to build a good propulsion system that can sustain. Oh, we can build one for an hour, for 2 or 3 minutes, but to sustain an hour and 15 minutes of Mach 3.2 flight, it's difficult to keep you alive thermally. That's one of the problems. Anything else? Go ahead. Yes, sir. Okay, two. We've got 5 minutes left because we want to be on time. Go ahead. Go ahead. I'm sorry. No. It's a single stick airplane. It's interesting. That comes up. The B model is a dual control. The trainer is a two control airplane. The RSO is focused on what he's doing. Just focused. He's so vital. I mean, yeah, you get so overwhelmed sometimes with managing things in the front seat. You know, things, little idiosyncrasies that you say, I'm not worried about that right now. The key is, never back yourself into a corner that you can't get out of. Never have two people back themselves into a corner that you cannot get out of. And the simulator, about 400 hours of simulator, we've all crashed the sim. We've all made fools of ourselves. We've all made mistakes and say, why the hell did you do that? And you're trained and trained and trained, and the goal is you will not make the same mistake at the same time. I've made mistakes, he's made mistakes, but we haven't made mistakes at the same time. Okay, go ahead. Yes. Because it's a safety precaution. If you go to emergency, the generators run until it blows up. If you're in normal, there are some protective devices to save the generator. If you go to emergency, it'll run until it melts. And you have to reset the systems. And right, I knew exactly what I did. And I went, second ride in the B model, and you say, now you're not going to do that. I couldn't do that. Anything else? Yes, sir. In Murmansk, we're looking at submarines. Okay, the SR never overflew the Soviet Union. We never had a mission directly overflying the Soviet Union. True statement. We came really close. Find the expression. We returned at Murmansk, and you could see the smokestacks of Murmansk. And 23 miles in, before our turn, as we're making the turn, we're looking 45 miles into the Soviet Union. We're looking at submarines. We're looking at the entire North Atlantic fleet sitting in Murmansk. To what resolution? 18 inches. You can see people walking on the deck. That's how good the system works. Well, optically, radar was a little different. We use radar, but we're looking at, we were looking at, okay, there have been overflights of Nicaragua, there have been overflights of Cuba, we've overflown many other countries, but we have not, by agreement with the Eisenhower and Kennedy administration, we have avoided overflying the Soviet system. But really close. 2 seconds and you're turning. And as you're turning, you're looking inside the country, and the cameras are good for 43 miles inside the country, and you can see the laptop. That's how good it was. That's how good it was. The backseater has both an alert. We have really high end in the front of the airplane. You see those two little bulbs in the front there that stick out? There's a lot of RF. We have a lot of RF energy to. We have defensive systems which are tailored to the individual missiles. So we load different defensive. We load in different defensive systems. And when we get a launch light, this system is putting out a tremendous. We just want to burn electrically, meaning just jam. Yes, ma'am. 2 minutes left. It's lead asbestos, and it keeps the airplane 50 degrees cooler. Think about that. Have you ever seen a white radiator in your car? Why is the radiator basically painted black? Black's a good absorber, but black's a good radiator. This airplane is 50 degrees cooler just because of the paint job. It's radiating out. Trust me. It's 50 degrees cooler. It's actually a dark blue, and then when we heat it up, it turns kind of a black. But that's it. We paint it that color to radiate thermal energy away from the airplane. And we keep it about 30 to 40 degrees in the bottom, 50 degrees in the top, just by the thermal radiation. Guys, it's 2 o'clock. Okay, one more question, because we have to end the two. Go ahead.
Where were the antennas?
There you go. There's a couple here. There are a couple hidden. We have some defensive antennas in the front, sensors. We're not worried too much about the back of the airplane, okay? But the antennas are there, and we range. We can range with four different radios. Yeah. Okay, guys. I hope it was informative. It's not as technical as you think. It's a beautiful airplane to fly. It's absolutely a gorgeous airplane to fly. It's like a woman when you dance with a lady. It's like waltzing with a lady. It just is. That's the way the airplane flies. That's how good it is. Okay, it's 2:01. I'm 1 minute late, and we have to stop. There's another presentation.